thank you for inviting me and for your kind words. I like to develop automated agents. And Nava earlier said, you know, what is our agents? Everybody has his own definition. Well, it's not CIA agents and not Shabak agents. They are autonomous. They know, in my terms, they are autonomous. They know how to plan. They are adaptive. They are able to learn. They cooperate with other agents, and they can face adversaries. Automated agents can, that interact proficiently with people, can be of three kinds. First, they can support people. For example, we have a project with General Motors when the agents support drivers in helping them, advising how to save energy in electrical cars when trying to set the climate control systems. Or our agents are deployed since 2007 in LAX, in Los Angeles Airport, helping people deciding where to put a random, unexpected checkout. Or I have another agent that was developed with support of Intel, where it was whispering in the ear of its users how to argue and how to discuss with other people. And I really like this agent because maybe one day it will help me convince my son to leave his smartphone and go do something. Okay, so there are other agents that we develop over the years that can replace people. For example, talking about argumentation and discussion, we built an agent that tried to convince people, you know, not to eat this cake, but rather much healthier food. It's really, really difficult. Or we have an agent that was developed with Shiba that replaces a speech therapist in training brain damage people. So we have advising, helping, we have replacing, and of course, an automated agent can also be used to train people in various domains. For example, we have an agent that knows how to negotiate with people and can be used to train people in negotiation. And let me show you this.
I was offered a job at ImagineWeb, and I have been asked to come in and discuss the terms of my employment. The topics up for discussion are the...
Yeah, okay. So this agent is able to negotiate both sides of the employer and the employee. Okay, so before you go to discuss your terms of employment, you can play with our agent and discussed all these things. So let's see how it is, how
position,
he's doing this.
Salary, a company car, pension, promotion, and hours. In order to prepare for the meeting, I am practicing with NegoChat, which is acting as my employer. The logic behind NegoChat is based on two bounded rational theories, anchoring and aspiration adaptation theory.
This is a real system. You can come. It's online.
At the start of this negotiation session, NegoChat presents a full offer. While we don't expect the human counterpart to accept this offer, it does provide an anchor or a basis for further negotiation offers. The agent incrementally focuses on one issue at a time, based on which issue is the next most important or aspired to. The employer's most important value is salary. NegoChat shows flexibility in negotiating for an aspired value salary and tries to find a counteroffer that yields a similar utility value to itself while incorporating the employer's request for salary.
Okay, so that was one system, and you can keep on coming. If you want, send me email and I will send you the link, and you can negotiate and train playing both sides. Another system that we developed that can be used and is used for training people is training young officers in the Israeli police in interviewing, I'm choosing my words carefully, interviewing suspect or witnesses. And it's in Hebrew. And the idea is that we would like to have a good interviewing capabilities for the our police officers. And instead of training in play roles with people, they can come offline, you know, every day, whenever they want, and interview this suspect, that its response depend on the question that they are asking. So let's just give a glimpse about this agent.
מה שלומך?
בסדר.
מה השם שלך?
אתה מכיר אותי, יש לך במחשב, אני גם על.
אוקיי, זה ספיץ', טקסט טו ספיץ',
זה
לא ריקורדר,
טקסט טו ספיץ'. כן, אני עובד בכרמיאל באלף, עבודות מתכת.
Let me just run it a little bit further.
האם עבדת בדירתם של משפחת כהן?
He can ask all sort of questions and get answered various about people and about questions. And the same questions asked in various settings will get different answers, and both for the content but also true or false and etc. Again, with this you can't train by yourself, but if you come to our lab you can do it. And this system that was developed for the Israeli police then led to a very large project funded by the Horizon 2020 project Law Train, where we tried to train a team of international investigators in joint interview and in joint investigation. Okay, so we have many intelligent agents that interact proficiently with people, and the question is there anything in common between all these systems? What is the technology, what is the methodology that can be used for building such a system? Each agent is special, but, and I take them, you know, they are personal, I touch to them personally, but, yeah, relationship, but in addition, there is some common thread to all of them. And the common issue is predicting user behavior. In order to build an agent that interacts well with people, the agent must be able to predict how the person, the human, will respond to its activities. If he's giving an offer, what will be the response? Will the person will accept the offer or not? If he's giving advice to set the climate control, the air conditioning in the car, will the driver accept it? You know, the best advice in order to save energy is to turn off the air conditioning. You don't want the agent to give such an advice. So these are, in any interaction, there must be predictions, and this prediction of the human behavior allows the agent to choose a good activities. And well, predicting people, why do I need it actually? Because, you know, I'm a computer scientist, I would like to maximize expected utility. Unfortunately, people usually do not maximize expected utility. Not that I know their utility, but even if I know they are not maximizing expected utility, and all the agents that you saw demonstrate this phenomena, as well as all these important research that said that people are sensitive to context, lack knowledge of their own preferences, they are affected by complexity, their emotions influence their decision making, and they have problem of self-control. As I said, people are always upsetting and annoying, they are ruining my experiments. Okay, so in order to do this, over the years, we developed some methodology on how to develop automated agents that interact with people. We always try start with some data. Why? Because we can't know some formal model of how people will behave. So we are starting with data. The problem is that while there is a lot of data around us, decided, you know, when we miss the turn by using Waze, or, you know, now I am sure Google are following me. Anyway, we have a lot of data, but there is much less data about the decision making of people, especially in complex and changing setting. So in order to make our life, in order to be able to do good prediction, when we don't have millions of examples, but much less, we always look also for human behavioral models. Because, you know, I like to have friends everywhere. So friends, psychologists, I go to them to get from them what do they think are the features that influence people decision making. While they can't give me a formal model. You know, I would like, they said, well, if your offer is improving, if you will increase the salary, then people will tend more to accept your offer. Well, that I know already. You know, but my issue is, how much do I need to increase? You know, if I will give him 20,000, will he accept it? If he's a computer scientist, programmer, probably not. So do I need to go to 30,000? But if in other domains, you know, 10,000 is good. So I need to be able to predict. I need to be able to have a formal model, a formal decision making that I can use by my agent. So I am taking advice from psychologists and social scientists, but I must use some machine learning models in order to be able to predict and build human models. And the problem is that usually my model is general model in the sense that I am usually finding very difficult to build prediction for specific person. Because, for example, in the car, by the time I will have specific model for this driver, he will not use my advice anymore. So I must use, because I will be wrong in my prediction. So I usually have a general human prediction model, but then it's as a time when I have specific data on a specific person, I am improving my model, and this prediction is getting to my agent. And my agent, he's able to maximize expected utility. He's able to solve, usually, some difficult optimization methods, or if it is interaction, especially in strategic setting, I will use game theory. Still, the integration of the machine learning model and the integration to the optimization setting on the game theory, then solving the optimization problems is always a challenge because, you know, the complexity is very difficult. But once I'm doing this, I can generate the action of the agent for the interaction with the human. And if I have some avatar or something that look nice, like the virtual suspect, it makes the interaction easier. Okay, so remember, data, machine learning, optimization methods, or game theory, this is the main aspect of my research. So now I would like to demonstrate this methodology in two projects that we had, and we'll see how time allows, how we'll get into the details. So the first project is about managing robots. And think about a UAV or drones. Usually I own UAV, you have two people flying it. Okay, and you have one, you know, this robot, you have one soldier or one firefighter managing and handling one robot. But this seems a little bit waste because we can have many drones and we can have many robots, and these robots are semi-autonomous, almost autonomous. Why will we have one person or two people on one robot, one drone? We would like to have one person that handles 10, 20 drones. This was the challenge of this project. And the question is, actually, why do we need, anyway, a person in the loop? You know, autonomous cars can drive by themselves. These robots are autonomous. You know, our project was search and rescue. The robots, I can tell you, go around, look for things. Why do I keep a person in the loop? Okay, because in my project, the robots were very cheap, $1,500 a robot. So they were getting problems, that I would say. Usually they work very well, so I really don't need one person on one robot. But, you know, they can bump into something, their laser is not the best. So there are many reasons when they are getting into troubles, and a person in a few seconds can help them, you know. This robot I will show you, you know, you can show them here, were used to get into the ladies' room in my lab and be stuck there. You know, if I wait enough times, I can go out, but if my colleagues, you know, I'm not a good driver of robots, but I have a young colleague, she, in a few seconds, the robot is out. So the robots can get help from the people. The robots can work together with the person, with the operator. So this is one case. And in addition, there are some situations where we prefer that the person will be involved when there is some life on stake, etc. So many times, as in autonomous cars, the owners don't still want to give the authority for the autonomous robot to make a decision, even though if you ask my opinion, you know, these robots usually make better decisions than their operators, but don't quote me. Okay, so there is one person, and these robots are getting stuck, need help, or they can just improve their performance, and people are trying to handle 10 robots, they are overwhelmed. You can come and try it. It's really overwhelming. So what do we suggest? We suggest that there will be an agent that will work together with the robots and with the operator, with the person, and together they will do much better than each of them separately. And the goal of our agent is to prioritize the tasks that are arriving to the operator. So here are the small robots. You know what they are doing? They are supposed to find this green balls, and they are moving. And as you notice, my students are very creative in creating videos. That's the way they are. The operator sees the things. So there are video cameras on the robots, and they are looking, searching, and they are autonomous. You can see all of them are moving around and looking, trying to find these green Okay. So how do I build an agent that helps an operator manage these robots? Okay, so we need two models. We need the human model and we need the robot models because the agent is supposed to integrate between them. How do we have models of the robot we need data. Data I mentioned. So we need data on the human behavior and data on the robot performance. Getting data on the robot performance, we did through simulation, and it was very interesting that we collected data in simulation and then used it for the performance of the robot in the real world. And we have data on human behavior. This was difficult. We need operators and we need to learn about them. We brought people, students to the lab and we collected data. And then using the machine learning, we got two models. Then the agent did optimization based on these two prediction model and provide advice to the human what action to do next. A lot of data that we collected, but nevertheless, only 30 human operators. So from the decision point of view, those people that are used to thousands and millions of examples, we had in the hundreds, which make the decision making, the prediction quite difficult. So we have agents. We wanted really to show that this agent really helps people and the robots to find these green balls. So we ran three experiments. Each operator came twice to the lab. One he played with the agent. One he played, managed the robot without the agent. The order were mixed, not to give advantage to any systems. And let me tell you about, so they either do it in simulation, in and out, or really in the lab. And let me tell you that for the real robots, I don't need to tell you, if you come and you see this, the agent really helps. And if I'm looking on average, without the agent, the people on average found 7 green balls. With the agent, it multiplied. It was 14 on average. But forget the average. All the people that participate in the experiments with the agent did much better. It's not the people did much better. It's the person, the robots, and the agent together did much better. And you play with it. You see, it's really, really helpful. And based on this, my student came and said there was a video competition in each guy about robots. And my student came and said, let's participate in this. Let's participate in this competition. And this was the video they generated on the project. And
dispatch?
Quick. There's a student missing in the northern section of the campus.
Give me the exact location. A unit is on its way.
In disaster environments, both the victims and the rescuers' lives may be in danger. Robot technology can provide solutions. Today's robots are semi-autonomous and require a human operator's help whenever they cannot handle the situation on their own.
Move Agent 3 away from Agent 4. Move Agent 4 away from Agent 5.
Manually drive Robot 6 to a better...
The fast-paced, simultaneous streams of data from multiple robots can be overwhelming and can be a grueling task for a single operator.
Your robots are too close together. Spread them around. Your robots are too close together. Spread them around. Manually drive Robot 6 to a better position. Move Agent 3 away from Agent 4.
Here in Bar-Ilan University, we have developed an intelligent agent that supports the human multi-robot team collaboration. The agent prioritizes the different tasks, filters the robot's signals, and generates warnings which enhance the operator's situation awareness, thereby allowing him to make better decisions. The agent uses a novel methodology combining machine learning and optimization techniques, which accounts for both the operator's abilities and the robot's performance in real time. Through extensive empirical evaluations, we have shown that our agent was able to significantly enhance the team's performance, which can translate into saving lives.
There he is. We found him. We got him. I'm sending you the exact location now. Dispatch out.
Okay, so as you can see, they really won the first prize of this competition, and that has to say, always listen to your students. we also use this agent for storage, where the operator needs both to pack and to manage the robots, things getting more complex, and again, the agent is very helpful. Okay, so that was about, I would like to have another example demonstrating our, so I told you about the cake, you know, and the quite healthy bars. And the next task was, can we convince people to use the, to eat the, oh, the other way around, by the way. We brought students to the lab, the ones that wanted cake, we convinced them to eat the bar, the ones that want their bar, we try to convince them to eat the cake. Okay, so how can we do that? Originally, we thought the students that, Ariel, that wanted to do this, he said, you know, there is argumentation theory. And the argumentation theory is a very well-developed mathematical model of argumentation, very well, very nice theory. And he was thinking that he will be able to build an agent using this beautiful theory. I'm a logician in my training, so I really like this theory. But the problem is that similarly to the fact that people do not maximize expected utility, they also do not follow argumentation theory. So what can we do? Again, we need to be able to predict people behavior also in argumentation. And so this is on one side. We are having model for the human argumentation, but nevertheless, using the argumentation theory is also a good idea. So we have the human argumentation, we have data, we are building the machine learning model, and we have some prediction model. This is getting again into the optimization problem of the agent. What does he would like to optimize? He would like to convince you. He would like to make sure you reach the correct decision according to his goal. Okay, so the model is on one side built on top of the argumentation theory. And the argumentation theory is presented using a graph of arguments and their support or then attacks. This is how it looks. And there is a very nice formal model that captures what is the strength of each argument in this model. So this is a start, just that people are do not following it, but it can be used as a basic for the prediction, as a basic for the formal model. So we have the argumentation framework, we have, and then we can continue with the human collection data for the machine learning. So that's what we did. We had two models. In addition to convince people how to eat, we also tried to convince them to do a master's degree in computer science. So we got them to the lab and collected data. Actually, they did it from home because it was online. We collected manually people arguing about these two topics. This was the way we got the data. And then we also gave them questionnaires about their opinion. And all in all, we have the data and the model, and then using the machine learning, we were able to predict in each time point what will be the argument that a person will give in this situation. Is was a distribution. We don't really know exactly because people are, I told you, upsetting. Okay, so we have the opponent model, the one that we try to convince based on the data, the formal model, the machine learning technique. We have the model. And then the question is, how do we model the formal interaction between the people and the agent? And as I said, while people are not following, don't maximize expected utility, they don't follow argumentation theory, but our agent does have a formal model. And the formal models that we used was from one set side was about this persuasion model, formal persuasion model that I show you. On the other hand, we needed to model the interaction and to understand how people will respond to different arguments. So, and we have a lot of uncertainty, and we also don't know what the other person knows, what are the other arguments he is aware of, what should we say. So in order to do this, we did a POM-DP, which is a way to model decision-making under uncertainty where observation. POM-MDP, it's partial observable Markov decision process. So we use this model and we integrated our prediction into the POM-MDP. So using this, we build the agent. The agent has a policy that is computed based on the POM-DP, and then we had to try it. So in order to evaluate it again, we brought to the lab students. You know, there were students that came for data collection. Now we had new students that came, and we tried to convince them to change their mind. And they were in these two settings, the chocolate vs bar, and convincing them to study to what their master says this in computer science and do this research. And as you can see, we compared with the humans that try to negotiate with one another and argue with one another with some baseline, very simple agent that was proposed in the literature. We implemented it, but it wasn't tried on people, and we tried it on people and our agent. And you can see that our agent did statistically significant better than the agent, and in the chocolate bar, he did also better than the humans trying to convince others. Just that you know, the convincing people is extremely difficult. Changing mind is very difficult. We didn't succeed much, but we did bit better than, but you come and try to convince me not to eat the chocolate and eat the bar, we'll see you. Okay, so if I will summarize, if you have agents, they can either replace people, they can be used to train people, or they can be used to support people. And in all these cases, what you really need, from one point of view, you need data and good machine learning techniques that in many cases you need to develop them specifically for your task. On the other side, you need to set the agent optimization problem, as we did in the POM-DP or in other method. And only if you integrate both of them, you get such a good performance, as I demonstrated in these two examples. Thank you.